Failed allocation of vaccines, ventilators, and antiviral treatments, leaving no ethical value behind in healthcare rationing. By Parag Patak, Tayfun Sönmez, myself Utku Ünver, and Bumin Yenmez. COVID-19 pandemic has spurred renewed interest in guidelines for allocating scarce medical resources. Guidelines cover a wide range of public health emergencies. The scarce items to be allocated are ventilators, ICU beds, antivirals, vaccines, etc. By and large, these guidelines in the field and scholarly literatures in bioethics and emergency healthcare restrict their attention to variants of a priority system as their allocation mechanism of consideration. In this paper, we argue that a priority system is too restrictive, presenting evidence on how decision makers who are restricted to existing guidelines often struggle to integrate or balance the desired ethical values. To increase the flexibility of the system, we propose a reserve system. We develop a general theory of reserve system design, and we relate our analysis to current societal debates and report preliminary policy impact. COVID-19 pandemic has motivated policymakers to revisit existing or issue new guidelines on allocating medical resources. These guidelines appeal to various ethical principles, including saving the most lives, saving the most life years, the life cycle principle, instrumental value, reciprocity, and equal access. These principles can compete with each other. For example, equal access ignores patient age, while the life cycle principle explicitly considers it. An allocation mechanism must implement the desired balance of ethical values. By and large, most pandemic allocation guidelines worldwide rely on versions of a priority system to implement the desired balance of ethical values. In a priority system, patients are ordered in a priority order or tiers, and resources are allocated following this order. In vaccine allocation, the priority order is usually based on priority tiers. In ventilator or ICU allocation, priority point systems based on single principle or multi-principles are used. Here's an example debate on the inadequacies of priority point systems for ventilator and ICU allocation. The sequential organ failure assessment score, SOFA, is considered a good proxy for mortality risk before a ventilator intervention. If the sole ethical value under consideration is the utilitarian goal of saving the most lives, a single principle point system based on SOFA scores may be a good choice for ventilator or ICU allocation. But if there are multiple ethical values, as urged by the majority of the experts, then a priority point system is too restrictive to reach an ethically compelling balance between the desired values. It maps individual attributes to a numeric scale, and therefore it cannot even incorporate principles which lack a cardinal and monotonic representation, let alone aggregate them. For example, it cannot accommodate distributional objectives such as proportional representation of disadvantaged groups. A priority system is restrictive because it allocates all units based on a single priority ranking, sometimes by mapping individual attributes to a numeric scale. Some principles may not have a monotonic cardinal representation, and others may depend on group structure. Aggregation across ethical values also raises the question of incommensurability. In real-life applications in early days of the pandemic, these limitations led to the abandonment of some widely endorsed principles. For example, essential personnel priority in New York and Minnesota was abandoned with the fear that only essential personnel would get ventilators, even with a slight increase in priority. Also, they led to vagueness while trying to accommodate multiple ethical principles. For example, age or essential personnel priorities were vaguely specified in Massachusetts and Pittsburgh. A remedy has to break a priority system's reliance on a single priority ranking of patients to allocate each and every unit. A reserve system divides resources into multiple categories and allows for distinct criteria for allocation of units in different categories. These category-specific criteria reflect the balance of ethical values guiding allocation of units in the given category. Reserve systems are used in many real-life settings, such as affirmative action, deceased donor kidney allocation, school choice, college admissions, U.S. H-1B visa allocation, allocation of marathon slots, etc. The primitives of the reserve system are the division of the total supply of resources into multiple categories, the size of each category, and a category-specific priority order of individuals for each category. In most applications, it's also necessary to specify what to do when an individual qualifies for a unit through multiple reserve categories. Since units are identical, an individual does not care about the category through which he receives a unit. However, this choice influences the outcome for other individuals. This last point is often misunderstood in real-life applications, resulting in unintended consequences. Here is our model. I is a set of patients, each in need of one unit. Q is the number of identical medical units in short supply. Cap C is the set of reserve categories. RC is the number of units subject to category C allocation criteria, such that the summation over all RCs is equal to Q. Pi C is the strict priority of order of patients for units in category C. In particular, I Pi C empty set means that patient I is eligible for category C. An outcome is a matching that is an assignment of each patient either to a category or empty set such that no category is assigned to more patients than number of its units. Here is our important modeling choice. So why do we need to specify through which category a patient receives her assignment? Because even though patients are indifferent between all units, their claims over units in different categories are potentially different. Almost all real-life reserve systems satisfy the following three fundamental axioms. A matching complies with eligibility requirements if patients only receive units from categories for which they are eligible. A matching is non-wasteful if no unit from any category remains idle despite the presence of an eligible patient who remains unserved. A matching respects priorities if no patient remains unserved, while a unit from some category C is awarded to a lower category C priority patient. We next formulate a natural counterpart of the standard competitive equilibrium for our model. For any category C, a cutoff FC is either a patient or empty set, such that FC has at least as much priority as empty set in category C. For a given cutoff vector F, the budget set of patient I is the set of categories for which she has at least as much priority as the cutoff FC. A cutoff equilibrium is a cutoff vector matching pair F mu, such that for any patient I, mu I is a category in her budget set if her budget set is non-empty and mu I is empty set otherwise. And for any category C, if all of its units are not assigned in mu, then FC is empty set. It is a widespread practice to describe the outcome of a reserve system in real-life applications through its cutoff equilibrium, often utilizing a metric that is used to construct the priority order at each category. Our first analytical result shows a strong link between our three axioms and the cutoff equilibrium solution concept. A matching complies with eligibility requirements, is non-wasteful, and respects priorities, if and only if it's a cutoff matching. We also show that all cutoff matchings can be constructed using an auxiliary two-sided matching market concept and Gale-Shapley's deferred acceptance algorithm. For each cutoff matching, in addition, there is a minimum cutoff factor and a maximum cutoff factor. We focus on the maximum cutoff factor as it is an indicator of the selectivity of a category. The maximum cutoff each category is the lowest priority patient matched with the category if it fills its quota and empty set otherwise. Not all reserve systems have to process categories sequentially, but in most real-life practices, they do. Sequential reserve matchings are obtained as follows. We fix a processing sequence of categories. Following this sequence, we allocate units in each category C to the highest category C priority patients up to the capacity. We show that every sequential reserve matching is a cutoff matching. We also show that the earlier a category is processed, the higher is its maximum cutoff, i.e. the more selective it becomes. In particular, the processing sequence of categories is important, resulting with different cutoff matchings, and reserves may sometimes be redundant. Next, we consider the following version of the problem, common in real-life applications. There is an unreserved category U with a baseline priority order pi U. Any other category C provides preferential treatment to a beneficiary group, cap IC. Pi C prioritizes beneficiaries of the category C over other patients, and pi U is used to prioritize internally within the two groups. We consider two different reserve systems. In the hard reserves, eligibility is restricted to beneficiaries only. And in soft reserves, everyone is still eligible. Especially two different implementations of sequential reserve matchings are important in real life. In the over and above implementation, reserve category is processed after the unreserved category, and this provides a stronger benefit and best suited for situations that warrant an extra boost for the reserve category group. In the minimum guarantee implementation, reserve category is processed prior to unreserved category. It provides weaker benefit compared to the over and above implementation, and it may provide no benefit at all if target minimum is already reached in the absence of the reserve. And this is best suited for situations that warrant a protective measure. The myopic sequential processing of the reserves, however, possibly leads to unintended efficiency loss under hard reserves and underutilization of reserves, which causes deserving patients not being assigned in favor of patients who do not need reserve protection. To remedy this problem, we introduce a new axiom. A matching is maximal in beneficiary assignment if it maximizes the total number of units awarded to target beneficiaries of categories. An immediate observation is that, together with non-wastefulness, maximality in beneficiary assignment implies priority efficiency. As a remedy to the problem of the sequential reserve matchings, we introduce smart reserve matchings. The main idea is determining which agents are to be matched with some category in a greedy manner following their baseline priorities, while assuring maximality in beneficiary assignment. This can be done in multiple ways, depending on when unreserved units are processed. If all unreserved units are processed at the end, this extreme case of our algorithm generates a minimum guarantee version of the smart reserve matchings. If all unreserved units are processed at the beginning, this other extreme of our algorithm generates an over and above version of the smart reserve matchings. We prove that any smart reserve matching complies with eligibility requirements, is non-wasteful, respects priorities, and is maximal in beneficiary assignment. In our final theorem, we show that of all matchings that satisfy these four axioms, over and above smart reserve matchings are the most selective, and minimum guaranteed smart reserve matchings are the least selective ones for the unreserved category in terms of the maximum cutoff. Our initial policy efforts. In March 2020, New England Journal of Medicine published what became to be a highly influential paper outlining the desired ethical principles for allocation of pandemic medical resources. As experts of allocation schemes, we observed the limitations of proposed priority systems and that New York and Minnesota had to abandon essential personnel priority in ventilator allocation as they were afraid that all units would go to essential personnel in a priority system. We worked on and circulated the first version of our working paper in April 2020, initially repurposing a book chapter in progress without most of the results presented here. 2 days later, Massachusetts announced its ventilator allocation guidelines, which had vagueness in essential personnel priority. We reached out to Robert Truck, a member of the committee and a leading bioethicist on triage protocols. Robert Truck proposed a collaboration also including two other leading experts, Govind Persad and Doug White. Joining forces with them, over the next several months, we engaged in various outreach activities to introduce the reserve system to bioethics and emergency care communities. We also began collaborating with Penn bioethicist Harald Schumet, who was especially interested in utilizing reserve systems to mitigate disparities in healthcare access. In May 2020, the first concrete outcome of our collaboration was a design of the antiviral medicine allocation guideline at the University of Pittsburgh Medical Center, which was subsequently endorsed and adopted by Commonwealth of Pennsylvania. By the late summer of 2020, our focus has shifted to the upcoming vaccine rollout. Since the beginning of the pandemic, there has been a vigorous debate on equitable vaccine allocation, purely focused on the structure of priority tiers under a presumed priority system. Melinda Gates in June 2020 advocated for tiering based on races, such that blacks receive first after essential personnel due to COVID-19's disproportionate effect on them. There was a great pushback from many fronts. In July 2020, CDC and NIH commissioned the National Academies of Sciences, Engineering, and Medicine, NASAM, to formulate their recommendations on the equitable allocation of a COVID-19 vaccine. A preliminary discussion draft of their framework was published in September 2020. Then comments from the public were solicited through a formal process. In his written and oral comments, panbioethicist Harald Schmidt has inquired about the recommended mechanism to prioritize members of hard-hit communities. In preparation for this contingency and in collaboration with Schmidt, earlier we circulated a working paper illustrating how easily a traditional tiered priority system can be modified as a reserve system by building equity into the system through an index of social vulnerability. This precise formulation was brought to the attention of the committee as a possible mechanism to embed equity in their framework. In September 2020, in response to the NASAM discussion draft, JAMA published also an influential viewpoint endorsing our proposed reserve system in their conclusion. In October 2020, NASAM published their final framework, which formally recommended a 10% reserve for people from hard-hit areas. Later, Tennessee and Massachusetts became the first two states to adopt this recommendation for hard-hit communities for vaccine rollout. In a number of group meetings, we introduced and advocated for the reserve system to California's Surgeon General. In March 2020, California adopted a particularly ambitious reserve system for its vaccine rollout. To this date, more than 20 U.S. states adopted different versions of COVID-19 vaccine rollout with different reserve categories. See our website covid19reservesystem.org for details. In November 2020, we designed the reserve system for Massachusetts for monoclonal antibody therapy allocation, which was later adopted. Conclusion. In the first few months of the COVID-19 pandemic, many societies were caught unprepared when they needed guidelines for a possible ventilator rationing. At present, there is still a worldwide need for policies and mechanisms for vaccine allocation. Poorly designed allocation mechanisms may damage the social contract between different segments of the society. Widely accepted but potentially competing ethical values for pandemic resource allocation require a mechanism to implement the desired balance of values. Finding the right mechanism to honor these principles is therefore important for maintaining the social fabric. When revising or modifying guidelines during or after the COVID-19 pandemic, a reserve system should be part of the arsenal. Thank you.